I think it's an interesting thing about this, to be part of a movement where we're still evolving. So I'm going to reflect on some of that today. So some of you know the Celtic calendar, this May 1st would be Beltane, one of the corners of the year, if you will, the opposite being Samhain or November 1st. And there's a lot of fun things about that, entering into the summertime versus entering into the winter, what that might mean for us. And when I was a kid, it was May Day, so we took flowers. I took flowers to my grandmother, let them on her porch. I'm sure she had no idea who it was. No idea. As I would knock on the door and run away. But in Ohio, southern Ohio, where I grew up, there were actually flowers blooming. We'd have to go to the store to get our flowers. But that was a really fun part for me, even as a kid, to recognize this with a turning, if you will. A lot of people will celebrate this time of year with dancing, with maypoles. I've heard some lascivious things that happen sometimes around these events. Well, definitely people here, actually. So it's kind of a fun time of year as well. And I'm sure you all have enjoyed these days too. One of my favorite images of this time is when the unseen becomes seen. The unseen becomes seen. So the little seed becomes seen. The bulbs start to burst. The trees are starting to pop. So it's a nice time of year for that. And the veil is thin. This is the other thing I like about this time also coming into November. The idea of the veil between the worlds is thin. So I'm not sure if you've seen sprites or fairies dancing about. I can't confess I haven't. Though at our house we did prepare our fairy table. We have a old table out in the woods. We made it and we set the table for the fairies yesterday, so that was kind of fun. So we like to play with these things. But also as we think about time, the thing I like about the Celtic calendar particularly is it reinforces something I've talked about here before about time being cyclical. Things come back to us. Sometimes we can look to the past as we prepare for the future and get some wisdom from that. And so at this time of turning, as I've been reflecting on this, I was reminded of a guy named Paul Kingsworth, and it's a great organization he helped co-found, well, great, radical organization, called the Dark Mountain Project. And he lives in England. But it's really a group of writers who feel like they need to start telling stories of our next age, if you will, of the turn away from some of the industrialization that we've lived with and the reconnection, so that turning back with the planet, recognizing our dependence on one another and on the planet, that the world we inhabit is not simply a resource for us to chew up and spit out and create wealth with, right? So really some interesting things. And what they talk about is they're looking for other stories, ones that can help us make sense of a time of disruption and uncertainty. So whether that's in the world or in our personal lives, looking for new stories. What he says, and this is what I'd like today for us, the real questions to be answered during this turning are not questions of politics, they're not questions about economics or even social morality. They are questions about what is missing from all this talk in the world that we have built. They are questions about what has meaning. We're using the metaphysics here, right? What has meaning? What really matters? What is greater than us? And how should we behave toward it, that which is greater than us, or which is internal to us, as we like to say? And those questions, whether we like it or not, are religious questions. But they're religious, not religion, but religious questions about what the world is. So here's my jump off into the action way. Forgive me if you will. Cheryl's writing it down, so she's going to be able to look it up. So Karl Jaspers, a German historian, proposed this concept years ago, back in the 1800s actually. And the idea that there's a period of time, so when we think about looking for radical change, sometimes people say, well, it's not going to happen. You know, the world just kind of plods along as it is. And he looked at that time from about 800 to 200 BC, and all these things that happened around the world simultaneously in a world that was not connected like our world is today. So in China, this was the time of Confucius. In Iran, there were some great religious leaders at that time. This was the time of the prophets. The Hebrew scriptures, when they were active in writing about a different way of thinking about justice and how we treat one another. Also in Greece, this was when Homer was around, a lot of philosophies that undergird what we call Western civilization happened at that time. So there was this radical shift that happened around the world. People of faith, of course, also recognize this as change in how we related with divinity and a spiritual change. So this radical transformation that happened. And part of what he points that out for, and what I like to think about, is one is it tells us that radical transformation is possible, that it happens in this history, it's happened before, and there was some really good change that happened at that time. And at least two other axes I want to suggest happened since that time. One's my idea, one's someone else's. One's less hopeful, that's mine, and one's more hopeful, that's someone else's. And one is the Industrial Revolution, the way in which most of us in this room, of course, have inherited this, right? We grew up in a time when the way we related to the planet, the way we related to other people was as resources for our benefit. And that's really, and that's been destroying the planet ever since. You know, it's also given us great wealth, in a certain sense. So that's one piece, this idea of a human-centered existence that we've grown up with, the world is designed around our needs and our wants. And then the more hopeful one, is this posed again by a couple of historians, Cousins and Swender. And what they argue is that this is actually, we've already are in the middle of a giant paradigm shift. Hans Kuhn calls it a macro paradigm shift, where we see the world globally, not just individually or in isolated communally, and that that's a hopeful thing. Because when we start to recognize our connections globally, that that might help us move us in a new direction. Now, we know others have connected that in globalization around certainly economic means to benefit the few at the expense of the many. So that's globalization by itself is not necessarily a wonderful thing. But again, this idea that we are in a shift right now where we might move from monologue to dialogue, both with our fellow human beings, but also with the planet, I would suggest with divinity, that that's a dialogical process, and that that's a hopeful thing in how we interact with one another. And so that's another story that I think is interesting to both rediscover and recreate in our time. At least we hope that that's the shift. So I like that idea of moving from monologue to dialogue. And I laugh at myself because now I'm talking about dialogue while I'm offering the monologue. And you all already heard me talk about how much I talk about silence in this space. So it's just something I have to live with. And you now have to live with because now I'm throwing that at you too. So there's a couple places I turn to today that I want to highlight for you. When I think about voices in our time, that might be offering us some guidance on these stories that we might be telling in our time. And I think unity is part of this as well, actually, the movement, the unity movement. So one is Climate Kids, which is what the Nation, one of the left-wing rags that I read, refers to the kids who are leading the climate conversation right now. This young woman from Sweden, who I read about the Water World Nation, kids who are saying to the world leaders, to the policymakers, to the adults, who are supposed to be the adults in the room, are saying the status quo will not work anymore. And so what power do they have to do things like strikes and boycotts? They quit going to school on Fridays, right? A friend of mine, I just saw a note from a friend of mine, she lives in Brooklyn now, who she said had a picture of her daughter participating in New York City in one of these protests that the kids had set up. And she says, you know, when I was a kid, I'd skip school and go to the beach. And you're my daughter, but what does she do? She skips school to hold a mirror up to us to say, we've got to change this. Our future is at stake. So I'm really motivated by that. And I particularly liked her idea, her, this young woman's idea, who talked about the status quo will not work anymore. That simply is not going to cut it. I think it's a really interesting challenge for us to think about how often we, especially I think in the West, we fall into these patterns where we don't always have the time to question it. So we're just marching along. And I think I love the idea of the children among us being the ones who are standing up to us and going, really? What in the world are you talking about? Let's stop this. The other place that I like to look, and this is both looking forward and backwards, and this is why you can connect with the Beltane, the idea of the veil being thin right now, and that is indigenous knowledge. One of the things that I really been moved by this week was an article, I actually had my class read it, so they're loving me for this. Mark Trahan, who's a native, he's a member of the Shoshone Bannock tribes. And he has an article in Yes that he talks about, it's called The Disruption of White Supremacy. He's really connecting, you know, I teach a course on race, so that's where this comes from. But the idea that our march towards colonization particularly is really wrapped up so much in white supremacy, and it has, of course, in history. But what I like what he talks about is that anytime we are looking at standing up against, and he's talking about colonialism, that we often talk about anti-colonialism efforts. We've talked before here about the difference between looking for what you want to create versus what you want to stand against, what a different world that is. So it really talks about the history, and now true apology, and I'm going to jump into it here a bit, but I'll come back, I promise. The idea that every anti-colonial effort has ended up in another expression of colonialism, right? So when Britain quit being a world colonizer, someone took their place. When Rome quit being an empire, another empire took their place. In more recent times, many anti-colonialism efforts have gotten rid of the overt colonialism, but there's still internal colonialism. There's all kinds of other ways in which a small group of people exert great amounts of power over a larger group of people and extrapolate resources as well. Okay, so the idea that if you only are standing against that, you may not be creating something new. But where does he turn for that? He turns to indigenous knowledge that predates colonialism. So it's interesting. So this is prehistory, if you will. So I'm going to quote a little bit here. He says, And what he's talking about is that what we actually need is a great disruption, not just to stand against something. It's kind of like the kids saying, we can't follow the status quo. We need a great disruption. And the native people, indigenous people, know what that is. So he says, there's growing evidence that my ancestors, and his ancestors, hunted mastodon in the Great Basin some 14,000 years ago. When the massive animals were extinct, the people had to adapt to this great disruption. Later, my Shoshone and Bannock people hunted buffalo. Disruption was followed by innovation. A similar story is found around 1100 in today's Southwest. Some of you may have been to these places. The ancient Pueblos built these extraordinary cities, some on the sides of sandstone cliffs. I want to go there. I've not been there in the Southwest. I want to see this place. But there was some disruption. We're not sure what it was. And by the 1400s, the people had moved to the Rio Grande region. An entire civilization, tens of thousands of people, moved and built a remarkable trading network. And Pueblo trade expanded greatly because of their new location. Disruption followed by innovation. So again, I think as we think about telling our new stories, sometimes it's interesting to look back and recognize that maybe they're old stories. Maybe we're retelling our stories again. And that idea of the connection. Now, there's a spark of this, of course, within New Thought. Cheryl, we appreciate you mentioning New Thought, I know. Free thinkers, transcendentalists, some of the originators behind Unity. Ralph Waldo Emerson, people we look to, I think, in this movement, said the end of the human race will be that it eventually will die of civilization. Okay, so civilization itself is part of the problem, is part of his understanding, which I still like. So what are a couple of the stories I want to highlight that I think we are telling here, and I think we continue to tell. Again, I'm really excited to be in the conversation with those of you who want to do this about how do we speak about this place and this movement to the larger community. I mean, it's really, really interesting. I've been working with Sarah and her colleagues at Gearbox about this, and we've already shifted some stuff because they noticed that some of the stuff on our website wasn't as wonderfully welcoming as what we say every Sunday. So we've already, if you've been to the website lately, you'll see we've already made a few shifts, and part of that is just to say, how do we speak to people about what this is and who we are and how we want them to be here in dialogue with us in a way that's really inviting and hospitable. And so I'll tell you a story now. Now you can do it, Cheryl. Thank you. So here's a line that I think is a great statement about hospitality. No worry or fear belongs in this world. Within these limits dwell hope and peace of mind. Here you are respected for what you are and all that you can become. Okay? So I throw that in. And now I'm going to tell you a story about where this comes from. It might surprise you. So when I was a campus minister, this is the early 80s, I'm sure you're all really surprised I was already an adult in the early 80s, but I was. I was at a conference, Lutheran Campus Ministry, we had regional conferences, so I was in San Francisco at the time, you know, and was invited by a couple men, pastors, Lutheran pastors, if I wanted to go out for a drink that evening. And I was like, sure, I mean, they were mentors of mine, this is such an honor to be invited out. And they were like, you know where we're going, right? And I was like, oh, sure, of course, you know, I'm a young, hip guy. I know what's happening here. Let's go. And we walked into what's a gay bar. So I had no idea. I was complimented, of course, that they trusted me in that space, which happened a lot to me when I was young. But it was, at that time, the 80s, was, of course, dangerous to be not just public and gay, but public and a Lutheran minister and gay, you know, ratcheted up, right? And so, so I, of course, was greatly complimented by the space and was saddened immediately by the thought that one of the few places that was hospitable to gay and lesbian brothers and sisters at that time was drinking establishments, not the churches. And this quote was on the wall behind the bar. So to me, that juxtaposition of working in a tradition at that time that I was part of the political move to try to say we need to be welcoming of all people. And yet here it is, I had to go to a bar to find that wall. I wish I still had the bar napkin because I wrote it down on a bar napkin and brought it back with me. And I've had it, I forgot about it until just this week actually. I've had it on my office wall for years. I created a massage for the calligraphy once to get that done. So that's been something I've carried around a long time. So I offer that as a story, not just about San Francisco in the 80s, but also one is a great image. And sometimes we may need to look in places we don't expect for those images that help us think about how we welcome people, how we tell our story. And I would suggest that part of the story here is encapsulated here, as I've talked to people about how hard we work to welcome people into this space and respect who they are and also who they may become, right? Welcome people regardless of your spiritual path. And we hope, right? We hope that this is a place where we might nurture those paths. It's one of the gifts we hope to give one another. So that's one piece of the story. The next one I want to mention is what I just enjoy about this idea of being an evolving ministry. And I'm not sure you all knew that about this place, but when I came, I started calling Kansas City Gems Flat and Smiling Advocates Divorce. If we talk about this, it's like, what do you mean we're not really a ministry? This place has been, we just celebrated this big anniversary, blah, 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 blah. And so I find out within their category, we're still evolving. And so we've talked with the board about some of the steps which aren't that radical to sort of become an official ministry. But I actually like the idea now of being evolving, because it says we're still growing. Right? We're still moving. We're still learning. And just one place I want to mention that I've talked a lot, I know already, about the class we did on the five principles, but it really was such an engaging conversation. But the idea of how even the five principles, which are kind of basic community, how they've evolved since they first came about, you know, actually it was something that was just sort of happening within the movement before things of granddaughter, great-granddaughter of the Fillmores, who put a pen to paper. And the title of her book will tell you it's evolving today, right? It was The Keys of the Kingdom. We don't talk a lot about the kingdom here, do we? Right? So it's evolved already from there. And then Cheryl Karen, I have no idea where the heck you all found this, but you may notice on the wall back here, they found a poster of the five principles buried somewhere when we were cleaning out an office. And as I was reading, it was like, that's not the five principles. That's different than the ones I have too. And then when we were doing the study, we found out that there's a book we were using, and they're also defined differently. And of the eight people, or nine of us, the nine of us in the room, and we had conversations about how would you put this into your language, we came up with very, very different expressions, right? And I think just in this dimension, because none of you and I have talked about this, I think the use of the word Christ is one of those turning points for us in this community. I had really good conversations with many people about how, and you've heard me talk about it before, I won't go into it ad nauseum, but that for some is a block, and for others it still connects with the tradition and recognizes that the transformation of that image of the Christ is part of unity's history. And yet I would suggest for others, and for myself certainly personally, the next step is what I'm really curious about. What's the next language we do where we express the five principles in a way that might not give some people a response back? We'd welcome people for whom the term the Christ finds meaning within unity, but also would be comforting and welcoming for those who don't. I don't know where that's going to go. Right? That's what I mean about it's evolving. That's why I find it energizing. But I think, again, that's part of our story. How do we speak about who we are within the larger movement, which is also welcoming of this community, that also might invite others to come add their voice to our dialogue about how we're evolving? Right? That's part of what the conversation is in a monological format. So, what I'm hopeful about is that we'll continue to tell our story, continue to find creative ways to tell our story. We'll do that together, rooted in our history, both here locally, but also within the movement, within the history that goes back prior to colonization, if you will. But also the courage to recognize that we really do need a new story. We continue to need new stories as well to break out of the ruts of the status quo, if you will, and take on the challenge of these climate. So at this time of the year, when the veil is thin and our transition to something radically different is called for, when we step outside, that sunshine today, we're being called to that radical transformation. We're being invited to that. Let's continue to be kind with one another, right, as we walk into that. And in dialogue, perhaps we can, in our own small part, play a role in the conversion, the transformation, to a story that really can sustain a world where all might glimpse that spark of the divine, which we see in one another and the world around us, right? That we might find stories that invite people to that world. We've got something to offer that conversation. One of my hopes is that we'll continue to do that. And today when you go outside, use all five senses, right? Let's all take time to stop, to smell, to taste, to listen, to feel, and to touch. Because one of the great books of knowledge is just sitting right outside these doors. And so it is. take a moment and imagine something that symbolizes for you that kernel that might come forth in new life here as we turn into May. What's an image for you? We had a young boy in my house yesterday looking for tadpoles, so his image is tadpoles. It might be the chicks that are down, the bunnies, or a flower, the tulips out here getting ready to bloom. So you can imagine that. Hang on to that image as we walk through our meditation. So if you take a minute to put your feet flat on the ground and cross your legs, allow the blood to flow as it may. Take a nice deep centering breath.
It's been years. baby in the cradle, still on the floor, don't matter anymore. And old trees just grow stronger, and old rivers grow wilder every day. Old people just grow lonesome, waiting for someone to say, hello and hello. Me and Loretta, we don't talk much anymore. She sits and stares through the back door screen. All the news just repeats itself like some forgotten dream that we both seen. Someday I'll go and call up Rudy. We work together at the factory. What can I say if he asks what's new? Nothing much with you. Nothing much to do. And old trees just grow stronger, and old rivers grow wilder every day. Old people just grow lonesome, waiting for someone to say hello and there, hello. So if you're walking down the street sometime, spot some hollow ancient eyes, please don't just pass them by and stare as if you didn't care. Say hello.